Dear viewers, Assalamu alaikum. Imam Hussain alayhi salam narrates, "Those who are silent on the oppression of others are guilty of oppression themselves." This hadith of an infallible Imam does not make us merely irresponsible, but rather makes us equally complicit in this crime against humanity. Grand Ayatollah Sayyid Ali Hussain Sistani, may Allah prolong his life, says, "Crying for Imam Hussain alayhi salam is not a ritual, but a constant struggle against our nafs or conscience." This clearly establishes that mourning or crying for Imam Hussain alayhi salam, or merely self-flagellating oneself during the month of Muharram, would not suffice unless one has the audacity to rise up and speak up against oppression, tyranny, and injustice. This video is also about a brutality and oppression, a heart-wrenching human catastrophe that unfolded in the state of Nigeria, Africa, and yet unknown by most of the people around. It is about a crusader, a stalwart of human rights, an oppressed man named Sheikh Ibrahim Yaqub Al-Saksaki, his wife Malima Zina Saksaki, his children and his supporters. He is a charismatic leader of the Islamic movement of Nigeria, a father of 6 martyred sons, a brother of a martyred sister, an uncle of a martyred nephew. He stood up against a tyrant and oppressive regime of the state of Nigeria, led by a tyrant M. Buhari, in return of which he had to sacrifice his 6 young sons being killed in front of his eyes. His sister was set ablaze and burnt alive in front of him. He was fatally shot, and his wife was similarly fatally shot. Both were arrested, and in 2015 they were held captive and are being held captive till this date without being charged. I am going to narrate you a summary of events unfolded since 2015, which began with the fateful and a heart-wrenching massacre known as the Zaria massacre in December 2015. Although many attempts were made in 2014 to kill and exterminate the Islamic movement of Nigeria completely by the Nigerian government, but what actually began as a trail of tragic events was the Zaria massacre of December 2015. Now, here is a report of the Islamic Human Rights Commission, London, that has made an humanitarian intervention in this matter and sent a report to the International Criminal Court at The Hague, Netherlands. The report contains a summary of events that unfolded since 2015. In February 2016, the Kaduna Judicial Commission of Inquiry was sworn in and commenced public hearing. However, sittings were stalled by the refusal of the security forces to allow lawyers to see the Sheikh and allow him the right of fair hearing. In March 2016, both lawyers and the people of the movement withdrew their participation from Judicial Commission of Inquiry. The commission, however, surprisingly continued to sit irrespective of the absence of the Sheikh and the leaders of the movement. The Judicial Commission of Inquiry submitted its report in August 2016, albeit it continued to sit even after the withdrawal of participation by the Sheikh and his people, but it established certain facts. A. That the Nigerian army carried out a massacre. Second, that the Nigerian army didn't follow any international rule dealing with civilian population. And third, that the weapons thought to be stockpiled by the Islamic movement people was found to be an untruth. They had leveled these charges against the people of the movement that they had stockpiled weapons to rise against the state. But this fact was found to be an untruth in the report of the Judicial Commission that submitted in 2016. Well, lawsuits were instituted seeking to enforce the fundamental rights of the Sheikh and his wife at the Federal High Court. These were initially delayed by the refusal of the army chief and military to put up appearances for the cases. The Federal High Court in Abuja ruled in favor of Sheikh Zakzaki and his wife Zina, declaring their detention as illegal and unconstitutional and a breach of their fundamental rights. The court also allowed Sheikh Zakzaki and his wife to travel to India for being medically treated in India's best hospital in Gurugram. The Shias of India, especially the ones who share cordial and warm relations with those in power, didn't pay any heed to his plight. The disgraceful treatment meted out to the Sheikh and his wife compelled them to run from pillar to post and scurry in lurch. Sheikh Zakzaki and his wife decided to go back to Nigeria and die a death of dignity there rather than to live a life of humiliation in India, because he is a true follower of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, who preferred a death of dignity over a life of humiliation. I'm going to ponder upon the gross violations of international law by the Nigerian government time and again with greater and greater impunity. Beginning with the Constitution of United Nations Organizations, Universal Declaration of Human Rights 1948, containing the basic of fundamental rights in number of 30 to all the people of the world. Beginning with Article 5. Article 5 of the UDHR says, prohibition of torture, cruel, inhuman or degrading treatment or punishment. Sheikh Zakzaki and his wife were made to bear this torture, cruel and inhuman treatments and punishment, and are still being in punishment since 2014 because they are being held under unlawful and illegal detention without being charged. This is in clear violation of Article 5 of UDHR. Moreover, Article 10, right to a fair and public hearing by an independent and impartial tribunal. When Judicial Commission of Inquiry was sworn in and commenced its public hearing in February 2016, it started its proceedings with a biased approach because it continued to sit irrespective of the absence of Sheikh and his lawyers. They withdrew their participation, but the Judicial Commission continued its hearing and proceedings without the presence of the other party. This was in clear violation of Article 10 of Universal Declaration of Human Rights 1948. Then, Article 12. Freedom from arbitrary interference with privacy, family, home, correspondence or attack on honor or reputation, and right to protection by law against such interference. This article was also grossly violated by the Nigerian army because there has been an intervention into his privacy, arbitrary interference and pestering of his family, home affairs, correspondence, and there was also an attack on his residence, also on the Islamic Center of Husseinia in Zaria. The Islamic Human Rights Commission, London, has also nudged the International Criminal Court at The Hague, Netherlands, to start its proceedings and investigations under various provisions of the Rome Statute to the International Criminal Court. The report of the Islamic Human Rights Commission, London, clearly mentions certain provisions of the Rome Statute and says that the case is made out under these provisions. Beginning with Article 7 of the Rome Statute, which says, crime against humanity means any of the following acts when committed as part of a widespread or systematic attack directed against any civilian population with knowledge of the attack. A. Murder, extermination, enslavement, deportation or forcible transfer of population, imprisonment or other severe deprivation of physical liberty in violation of fundamental rules of international law, torture, rape, sexual slavery, enforced prostitution, forced pregnancy, enforced sterilization, or any other sexual violence, and many other acts. A case is clearly made out under Article 7 of the Rome Statute to the International Criminal Court, which defines crime against humanity, because all these acts were brutally and glaringly committed in the broad daylight by the Nigerian army. Well, there are other provisions of the Rome Statute to the International Criminal Court which are mentioned in the report of the Islamic Human Rights Commission sent to the prosecutor of the ICC. It says that there does exist a proper and appropriate jurisdiction of the International Criminal Court to initiate proceedings against the Nigerian army. Article 53 of the Rome Statute to the International Criminal Court says, initiation of investigation. The prosecutor shall initiate an investigation when the information available to the prosecutor provides a reasonable basis to believe that a crime within the jurisdiction of the court has been or is being committed. The Nigeria saw brutal attacks on the civilian population on 12th, 13th and 14th December 2015. There are ample evidences, direct, indirect, primary and secondary. There are witnesses available. There are photographs available on various websites. There are witnesses available to testify that these grave offenses were brutally committed by the Nigerian army. So therefore, there is no excuse or any scope for the prosecutor of the International Criminal Court to elude its responsibility of initiating an investigation under Article 53 of the Rome Statute to the International Criminal Court. In the last, a very important provision of Rome Statute to the International Criminal Court, and that is Article 67. It says, Article 67, Clause 1, the accused shall be entitled to a public hearing, to a fair hearing conducted impartially. No public hearing or fair hearing was conducted impartially when the Judicial Commission of Inquiry was sworn in and commenced in February 2016. So this was clearly violated. Subclause B of this Article 67 says, to communicate freely with the counsel of the accused. This is one of the rights of the accused, to communicate freely with his lawyers. However, his lawyers, when a suit for the enforcement of fundamental rights was filed before the High Court of Abuja, Federal High Court of Abuja, then the lawyers of Sheikh Zakzaki were intimated and Sheikh was not allowed to meet his lawyers. This was not only when the petition for enforcement of fundamental rights was filed in the Federal High Court of Abuja, but rather when Judicial Commission of Inquiry was commenced in February 2016, the same incident happened, that the Sheikh and the lawyers both were not allowed to meet each other. So they were denied. This right was completely denied to Sheikh Zakzaki, that he was not allowed to communicate freely with his lawyers. Subclause C of the same article says, to be tried without undue delay. This is another right of the accused, to be tried without undue delay. Sheikh Zakzaki and his wife are being held under unlawful detention since 2015. And this detention has been held to be illegal and unconstitutional by the Federal High Court of Abuja recently. But still, the Nigerian government continues to hold them in detention without being charged. So this is in clear violation of Article 67, subclause B and subclause C. Well, dear viewers, it is the responsibility of every one of us to stand up against this oppression and raise our voices against such tyrannies and injustices, because it is this lesson that was taught to us by Imam Hussain alayhi salam in the battlefield of Karbala 1400 years back, that whenever a tyrant comes to power, we have to stand up and fight against him. Thank you.